We now move on to questions to the Minister of Culture, Arts and Leisure, and I call Sammy Wilson.
Question number one.
Thank the member for his question. My department has planned to spend approximately £3,850,000 on Irish language projects in the 2014-15 financial year. This figure includes £3 million.
Order, members. I would ask members to desist from conversation on the benches, Minister.
This figure includes £3,062,107, which has been allocated to Fort na Gaeilge for the 2014 calendar year. Funding is also available from departmental mainstream projects, programmes for projects which have an Ulster, Scots or Irish language or cultural dimension, but which cannot be separated from the primary funding objectives.
I call Sammy Wilson.
For her answer, what reductions will she be making in the Irish language budget this year as a result of the 6% reduction in her budget due to her party's decision not to implement welfare reform and therefore reductions in budgets across the board?
I have no plans to reduce any budgets for the Irish language or Ulster Scots this year.
I call Rosie McCorley.
Can I ask the Minister, given the success of LIFA, has she been lobbied by Ulster Scots activists for a similar type of initiative, and has she considered bringing something like that forward?
Thank the member for her supplementary question. I haven't been lobbied by Ulster Scots activists in relation to bringing forward a similar type LIFA type project to the Ulster Scots. Since the LIFA was launched in September, I have asked the Ulster Scots Agency and indeed the Ministerial Advisory Group on the Ulster Scots to bring forward a similar programme because I believe it would add value to what they already do. The MAG Ulster Scots Academy is facilitating a partnership with other sectoral bodies. I know the Ulster Scots have strong community links with lifelong learning elements to them, and I thought it was the intention to bring something forward in a vein such as that. However, all main sectoral bodies are participating in the work on a collaborative basis. But despite this, there does seem to be almost a reluctance to bring a similar type of initiative forward. I have made it clear it doesn't necessarily have to be on the Ulster Scots language, because I understand that there's no agreed standard. However, I would be keen to see some programme, some similar type initiative based on culture and heritage.
I call Joe Byrne.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I thank the Minister for her answers. Would the Minister accept that the LIFA project has been very successful for people involved in the promotion of the Irish language? And is there any plans to extend it, given that there is a growing participation among groups in relation to the language?
Well, I thank the member for a supplementary question, and I absolutely agree with him. At the minute, we're well over 7,500 people who have signed up for LIFA. The original target set out in September 2011 was 1,000 for 2015. That was surpassed by December of that year. We then set another target for 2015 for 2015 again. That was surpassed and set it for 5,000. And that was reset again at 10,000 given the popularity. We will extend it where the demand is there. I'm currently hoping to meet with some of the other organisations and groups who have expressed an interest in LIFA bringing it forward, and that includes on an all learning basis. But certainly happy to extend the programme where the demand is.
I call Jim Allister.
The Minister has already made some cuts and announced some cuts in respect of other aspects. Why is it that she is making this boast that when it comes to efficiency savings in the North-South bodies, such as the language body, it's her boast that she refuses to make them? And now she is refusing to even entertain efficiency cuts which her party are imposing on the rest of government by their actions. Why does she think that that particular sector should be immune from cuts? And is it not just typical of the financial anarchy that she's presiding over?
The Member has asked this question, Minister.
Well, first of all, it's not a boast, it's just a statement of fact. There has been a strong reluctance on my behalf, and indeed a refusal on my behalf, to bring additional efficiencies to the language bodies that were up to three, as high as 4.5% in addition to what was already agreed. This would have a huge impact, particularly on the Ulster Scots, which would affect, in the main, I would say with some confidence, the majority of which are from the Protestant Unionist and Loyalist community. It's ironic that an Irish Republican is protecting the interests of the Protestant Unionist and Loyalist community when an elected representative who claims to represent that community is wanting me to wield the axe on people who need it most.
I call Sydney Anderson.
Question two, Deputy Speaker.
Thank the member for his question. Funding for my department is available through the Ulster Scots Agency and the Arts Council. In 2013-2014, the Lisley Lambeg Drumming Club received £1,500 through the Arts Council Musical Instruments for Bands programme. In 2014, the Ulster Scots Agency, through its financial assistance scheme, has allocated £7,750 towards tuition for Lambeg drumming groups. And in addition to this, groups can also apply to the Arts Council's lottery-funded small grants programme towards tuition and music classes.
I call Sydney Anderson.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for her response. And Minister, I'm here today to try and drum up some support for the drumming fraternity. Maybe you are or maybe you're not aware that Lambeg drumming is a big thing in County Armagh and throughout my constituency in Upper Ban. And it's also very much to the fore within the local Orange Lodges down in the constituency. Can the Minister tell me what more she can do with her and her department to further give more finance and resource, and what effect the Ulster Scots Agency, how will they be affected by the cutbacks? Thank you.
Well, the member was in the chamber when I answered the member for North Antrim in terms of additional cutbacks to Ulster Scots Agency. I think the member, I certainly appreciate the work that bands do, particularly within the community, particularly in rural communities, where more often than enough the bands are the community and help bring people forward. I think it's about demand. If there's a demand, then certainly the agencies, and in this case the Arts Council, the Ulster Scots Agency, will bring forward additional bids, but that hasn't been the case thus far, so there needs to be certainly a head of steam build-up in terms of the demand for it. It would be different, though, if it was done in isolation, but certainly in the case of the Lambeg Drumming Club in Lisley, or is it Lisley or Lisley, that it has received some small awards from different forms of funding, and that seems set to continue.
I call Oliver McMullen.
Good. Can the Minister give a breakdown of funding presently available to bands?
Well, certainly in terms of the Arts Council and the Ulster Scots Agency, the Arts Council Musical Instruments for Bands programme provides grants from £500 to £5,000 for the purchase of instruments. And this scheme is available to bands based in the North, which are formally constituted. Funding is also awarded by the Arts Council through its lottery-funded small grants programme for band-related activity, which includes equipment and tuition. For items over £10,000, funding is available from its equipment programme. And bands can also apply for funding for musical tuition from the Ulster Scots Agency through its financial assistance scheme.
I call John Dallett.
Mr Deputy Speaker, I thank the Minister for her answer. I'm sure the Minister will recall that one of the most successful groups in Northern Ireland in recent years was called Different Drums. And would the Minister give serious consideration to encouraging the integration not just of the drums but the accordions, the pipes and everything else, so that we all can enjoy the music together?
I certainly would, and the member may be aware of certainly the Walt City Tattoo, where there was a combination of two cultures, two communities come together, celebrating each other's cultures with inclusivity, with respect, and certainly diversity through dance, song and music. And if ever there was an example of what we need to do more of, that's one of them.
I call Robin Swan.
Thank you very much, Mr Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for her answer. But not letting the member for Upper Ban steal all the glory, there's a great Lambeg drumming tradition in North Antrim as well, and they're better drums. Minister, your department does give support to the Ulster Pipe and Drumming Schools as well. Would you consider such an appeal from the Lambeg Drumming Associations as well?
Well, the Lambeg Drumming Association have received funding from the Arts Council, they have received funding from the Ulster Scots Agency, and they also have received funding from the Ministerial Advisory Group. What I said to the member for Upper Ban, if there's a demand for additional funding based on evidence of need, I'm sure the agencies will happily consider that. And it's good to see that the Lambeg Drumming Association has such widespread support throughout this House today.
I call Dagi Mackay.
Question number three.
Thank the member for his question. I have asked that an arts strategy akin to the Sports Matters strategy be brought forward to address increasing attendance and participation in the arts while contributing to an inclusive society and stronger economy. The strategy will aim to complement the developing tourism sector, promote the creative industries and underpin the value of community arts and festivals. I believe that it's time that the full benefits and value of the arts to individuals, to communities and indeed to the economy and wider society are acknowledged and recognised. A draft strategy proposals will be brought forward for public consultation during 2015, and I look forward to meaningful and innovative collaboration and engagement with all stakeholders, including ministerial colleagues, to develop this strategy.
Again, can I ask members to desist from conversations which are interrupting those who wish to listen to the answers from the Minister. I will remind, perhaps once more, or I will be naming those who are interfering. I call Dagi Mackay.
Can I welcome the work that the Minister is doing in this area, certainly as somebody who knows well the link between tourism and the arts in my own constituency. Can I ask the Minister what she sees as the future role for the arts in the North and how we can make this more inclusive and open to people from all backgrounds?
Well, looking to the future, I want to see arts and for arts to be seen to be something to be enjoyed by everyone across our society and that it is valued and appreciated by everyone. I also want to see the arts being seen as a serious and important career choice for children and recognised through education and employment structures. I also want the arts to be valued as a contributor to health, to the economy, and indeed to the whole notion and the feeling of citizenship. In terms of the economy, I want to see arts that produce the best for people at national and international and indeed local level for visitors and potential visitors who will see our arts offering as a reason to come here and more importantly to return to the island. I think arts have a lot to offer, but I do think there's some way, certainly within this House, that arts is seen as a right and certainly not seen as a luxury. And until we get to a stage where it's recognised across the executive and across the parties, then I believe that arts are constantly placed at a disadvantage by some.
I call Karen McKevitt.
Speaker, in her reply, the Minister talked about stakeholders. And can I ask the Minister what type or what stakeholders that her department would consult in developing policies and how often is the database that's held by the department updated?
Well, I thank the member for her question because I think that the last strategy for the arts was done in 2001 and I'm sure she'll agree with me it's far too long. It was then called face-to-face. Stakeholders, I mean, I signed off just very recently on a terms of reference. There'll be full public consultation which will certainly start in early spring of next year. The consultation will happen in the normal process, but certainly I'd like to go out to arts groups and communities and individuals that I've been lobbied by to give them an opportunity to feed in, because a lot of people who work in the sector have a lot to offer, but don't often get the opportunity to input into government strategies. And it is really important that we do make sure that we go across as many of the communities as possible. So using places like our libraries, using places like schools, residence groups, community groups, any possible access to the community to make sure that it's as broad and inclusive as possible.
I call Nelson McCausland.
Within any strategy for the arts and culture, there will be a number of important key organisations. One of those would undoubtedly be the Ulster Orchestra. Would the Minister acknowledge the financial issues concerning the Ulster Orchestra and give a commitment to ensure that it is sustained to play its continued important role within our cultural infrastructure?
Brass Neck comes to mind, but will say nothing. Certainly value the role of the Ulster Orchestra, but as the member will know, I certainly can't give a commitment to bail out or plug the gap that the Ulster Orchestra are currently experiencing. However, I'm really, really keen to ensure that the Ulster Orchestra continues, that enough stakeholders and sponsorship is brought to the Ulster Orchestra, and happy to assist them. And indeed, as a member may be aware of plans to meet the Ulster Orchestra very, very soon, and would look forward to hearing what plans they have to meet the deficit in their budget.
I call Basil McRae.
Question number four, please.
Thank the member for his question. Responsibility for the management, maintenance and development and restoration of inland waterways for recreational purposes lies with Waterways Ireland, one of the six North-South implementation bodies. There are currently no plans to introduce an annual fee for boat users. Waterways Ireland operates a charging structure for a variety of services to users of the waterways across the Waterways Ireland network. These vary from £1 per passage through a lock on the lower band to €153 for winter marines along the Shannon.
I call Basil McRae.
Does the Minister think it is appropriate that luxury boats should be able to travel without paying a fee when, for example, a car has a car tax? And given the lack of capital investment in the waterways, perhaps this would be an appropriate way of raising the necessary revenue to spend on the infrastructure?
Well, I think there's a myth that anyone using the waterways has a luxury boat or yacht. Maybe the member's friends have luxury boats and yachts. But certainly the people that I've spoken to on the waterways of Leffenbrath Island don't. And currently at the minute, their bylaws are out for consultation, Waterways Ireland, and they're looking at fixed penalties, they're looking at speed limits, they're looking at respectful mooring and responsible parking. But certainly, you know, much more smaller and respectable boats that are on the waterways by people who from time to time certainly would cruise up and down the length of our waterways, but certainly not in anything substantial.
I call William Humphrey.
Speaker, could I ask the Minister, given the committee's recent visit to Fermanagh and Waterways Ireland, in lovely offices that cost £13.5 million, the Chief Executive admitted to the committee that she's having to make choices as to whether to make to fund some of the jetties that are about to collapse into the lock. Can I ask the Minister what influence can she have, or the Tourism Minister, but obviously in specific regard to your own portfolio, ensuring that we have the investment in the proper infrastructure for those who are tourists, especially tourists who travel to Northern Ireland to fish and use our waterways?
I think it is really important that, in this case it's Waterways Ireland, that manage our budgets appropriately. I mean, the cost of the premises and the running and the maintenance and the upkeep would have been in the original outline business plan. Are there things that Waterways Ireland could do? I mean, they have said, or it has been reported, that they have space, certainly lease some of that space out to accrue some money that they could spend. There are many things I'm sure that they could do, but certainly Don Livingstone's very, very responsible Chief Executive, who is more than aware of the potential of tourism and certainly what Waterways Ireland would like to do. If given even small amounts of money, modest investments have went a long way and have accrued a lot of benefits, particularly in rural areas around the waterways. I have no doubt that the Chief Executive of Waterways Ireland will bring this to our attention at the next sectoral meeting.
I call Sean Lynch.
I'll get the last hand call, yeah. Can the Minister give an update on the plans to restore the Ulster Canal? Mark.
I thank the member for a supplementary question. I mean, the Ulster Canal is certainly an example of, while the main project was due to commence, and certainly the financial situation, particularly with the Irish Government, put that to a halt. So rather than waiting on the money being all brought in at once, we're starting to look at options. I mean, the member is aware that there's an interagency group set up around the Ulster Canal. I mean, even just through previous correspondence and meetings he's raised this. I'm meeting a new Minister for Arts and Heritage in the Gaeltacht, Ms Heather Humphreys, next week, to look at ways in which we can start work and start looking at bringing a phased approach to the restoration of the upper or the Ulster Canal, the Upper Lougher and the Clonus part of it.
Moving on, I call Chris Hazard.
Question 5.
Thank the member for his question. And since 2009, Sport NI has invested funding of almost £48 million towards increasing participation levels across our population through a variety of programmes. Since active communities began in 2010, opportunities have been provided over 175,000 young people and almost 135,000 females, just over 30,000 people with a disability, and over 27,000 older people. Examples of other promotional activity include funding for programmes such as Active Awards for Sport, Active Clubs, Box Investment Programmes, and ongoing investment in sporting facilities, which are developed to encourage participation by all members of local communities. A range of activities are also provided by other partners involved in promoting opportunities in sport and recreation. These partners include the sports governing bodies such as the GAA, rugby, IFA, public bodies such as the Public Health Agency, the Environment Agency, Outdoor Recreation, and other leisure organisations such as angling clubs have also been included.
I call Joanne Dobson. Apologies. I call Chris Hazard.
And thank the Minister for answer. Can I ask the Minister to perhaps provide an overview of how Sports Matters Targets is helping to increase participation amongst the elderly, women and indeed the disabled?
Well, the Sports Matters Implementation Group looks at the progress certainly from the period from October to September 2013 and has recorded progress against each of the targets. The target to increase participation rates amongst older people by 6% is deemed to be on track, with an achievement of an increase by 9%. The target to increase participation rates amongst women by 6% is also on track, with an increase so far of over 17%. And then target to increase participation rates amongst people with a disability is 6%, is deemed to be on track but with some delay. Certainly, while in relation and in comparison to the Sports Matters strategy, they're certainly on track, but I hold the view that the progress is good, but certainly in the case of disabilities, we're doing well, but we need to do more.
And I now call Joanne Dobson.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. Does the Minister agree with me that multiple benefits accrue from involvement in sports, not least promoting physical and mental well-being and social inclusion, which all support the health service by reducing demand on cardiovascular services, diabetes and obesity, to name but only three?
I wholeheartedly agree with the member. It's really, really important. I mean, as well as looking at obesity, as well as looking at healthy hearts, we also have the whole area of mental health, healthy minds as well. And certainly with increased sport and physical activity, they have, you know, tremendous health benefits, but even particularly for older people who are at times forgotten, certainly looking at tailor-made bespoke programmes for them is really, really important, because not only does it keep them active, it also keeps them mentally active as well. And the social inclusion brought forward by certainly some groups that have a sporting and a leisure dimension has been proven to be very, very successful. So for all those reasons I've outlined, and I'm sure more that the member and I could mention, it is really important that investment for sport, but particularly for those targeted areas of women, older people and those with disabilities, is vitally important.
I call Gordon Dunn.
Deputy Speaker, does the Minister recognise the need for greater participation by all in sport, and does she agree that the better use of shared facilities between schools and local government would make a positive contribution to this?
Absolutely. The Minister of Education and I launched guidelines to better sharing of facilities last year, or even earlier this year, but certainly the guidelines have been in circulation from last year. The whole idea has been there for decades. The member may be aware, but even in my own constituency, and certainly the evidence from other constituencies, were that there were lots of reasons put up by schools in particular for not opening the gates past 4 o'clock. I think we've all seen through that. Now schools are willing partners, boards of governors are willing partners, And certainly with the new super councils, they will be willing partners as well, because apart from not having the capital investment to build the facilities at the end of each corner, to be flippant about it, it's much better when we share facilities, because not only will the investment will be used to better effect, but will actually help to create additional investment in the future when there's a better joined up approach. It will actually help in terms of sustainability and maintenance of schools, and it will also help people who will feel part of the community that aren't outside looking in the facilities that they can't use.
Questions number 6 and 12. I call Sean Rogers.
Number 7, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
My department is currently considering a number of opportunities for capital investment in the South Down and Newry and Armagh constituencies. For an example, a proposal is being developed to build a new Armagh City Library, and the Armagh Planetarium Observatory has registered a requirement for new CCTV equipment and maintenance works. No capital budget exists as yet for 2015-16, and when the executive makes investments allocations in due course, these and other projects will be considered for funding in light of departmental priorities and available budget.
I call Sean Rogers.
Could I thank the Minister for her answer thus far? Minister, the South East Coast Master Plan includes proposals for development of sports and leisure facilities throughout the towns in South Down. Could I ask you, what input has your department into those proposals?
I've heard of different master plans, particularly from different council areas, and certainly I'm happy to write the member on the specifics of it. But needless to say, that certainly even in the North West, where we've partnered up with Coleraine, with Dungiven and Limavady and Derry City Council, I'd hope to have the same approach across new council areas. I think it's better spent. It's better when there's different agencies and stakeholders and people bringing their purse strings and their purses forward. But certainly I'll make a query on the South East Coastal Master Plan. I'm happy to write the member with details.
I call Cathal Boylan.
I'm going to thank you and thank the Minister for her answer. Minister, I welcome the news about Armagh, but could you give us an update on the planned refurbishment of Crossmead Lane Library? Cormill Moggett.
Work is being led and undertaken by Newry and Mourne Council. Crossmead Lane is part of a local community centre, and the Council is upgrading the centre's facilities, which in turn helps the library. Newry and Mourne Council is carrying out some small-scale improvements to the library at a cost of £52,000. Library NI, which leases the library space from the Council, is paying for this work from its resource and maintenance budget. And Libraries NI has informed the public of what is happening. During the closure, a temporary mobile library service has been operated from the square across McLean. The library is expected to reopen in approximately a month's time.
I call William Humphrey.
The Minister may be aware of Ardley and Regeneration Trust is doing great work in Ardley and House in Newcastle, County Down. Many kids from constituencies such as hers and mine will have travelled there and continue to travel there right across Northern Ireland. Can I ask the Minister if there's any extra monies that are available in her department, that the extra funding going in there, or indeed funding going in there, in terms of equipment or capital investment, would be very much appreciated by the Trust, because it's pretty much a voluntary activity and people giving up their own time and talents?
Well, I am familiar of the Trust, and certainly even the member through the work of the Scouts, but even other groups, youth groups and community groups, have visited those premises and availed of those services over decades. I'm not aware of any current funding application. I'm certainly happy to make inquiries and copy the member into correspondence.
Moving on, I call Gerry Kelly.
The Cross Community Youth Sports Programme, being led by my department, will seek to deliver a meaningful and sustained impact on good relations through the power of sport. Alongside this, the programme will seek to promote equality and tackle poverty and social inclusion. It is important that the programme is delivered in areas of multiple deprivation, as these are often experiencing significant levels of conflict and interface tension. This is reflected in the fact that two areas selected for the pilot scheme in 2014 and 15 are areas of multiple deprivation. The rollout of the programme will seek to identify other suitable areas, including both rural and urban, to maximise opportunities for young people.
And that is the end of our time for listed questions, and we now move on to topical questions.
and I call Declan McAleer.
The Minister will be aware that Omagh will play host to the 2015 Irish Cyclone Championship. Does she agree that this is a remarkable achievement by Omagh's Wheeler Cycling Club and will be a great boost for cycling in the area?
Well, I'm aware that there was a proposal, certainly by Omagh, and I'm happy to again meet the member to further discuss this. I believe competitions and events around cycling, and particularly around sport and physical activity, are to be welcomed, and I'm particularly delighted in rural areas where the member and other members in this House often complain that a lot of funding, particularly around sports and physical activity, is based in cities.
I call Declan McAleer for supplementary.
Well, good. Does the Minister feel that her department can play a role in helping to maximise the sporting, social and economic benefits of this competition for Omagh and the wider area?
Well, in short, yes, but that doesn't mean to say that the member can then walk in and expect to get the initiative funded. I'm certainly disappointed to hear the comments from the Deputy Minister that events will no longer receive funding. I hope, certainly in relation to the Omagh Riding initiative, that this isn't one of them.
I call Peter Weir.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister, in light of the reduction in funding for a range of events across Northern Ireland, most of which are either cultural or sporting, what additional assistance her department can be to those events?
Well, certainly the member will be aware that in 2010 events was transferred from DCAL to Derry, and that investigation is still ongoing. It is with regret, and it is with regret even from the Derry Minister and myself and other executive colleagues. I'm quite shocked and disappointed that the events funding, particularly around tourism, has certainly been scaled back, if not ceased. Even just listening to media reports this morning, certainly I'd be having discussions with my own officials, having discussions with local councils to see what additional funding they can bring forward, because it is important that we ensure that these initiatives continue.
Paul Peter Weir.
I appreciate the response and appreciate the fact that there are constraints on budgets. Does the Minister have any suggestions as how, either through a department or through arm's length bodies, they can at least give some degree of assistance in kind to these events, which may not be a direct financial contribution but can perhaps ease the burden in other ways?
Well, certainly, I mean, the skills and experience that DCAL officials and even the officials from the arm's length bodies have in relation to helping people prepare business plans and possibly attract funding and sponsorship is there. And if the member has any specific examples or any requests, I mean, I'm more than happy to receive those. But let's be clear, what we don't need is a cut from one department and then another department is expected to pick it up, because that's not happening either.
I call Oliver McMullen.
Can the Minister comment on how the new super councils will implement the sports matters strategy and that they will be fully inclusive, particularly in relation to provision of facilities for the disabled?
I thank the member for his question. I'm sure he was in here when we discussed the sports matters strategy earlier. It is important that all the councils in their current configuration and in future configurations not only are part of the sports matters implementation group but actually implement the sports matters strategy, and particularly in relation to disabilities, those people need our help and support more than most. So I'd be very, very keen to ensure that the new super councils play their role as robustly as the old ones did.
I call Oliver McMullen.
Can I thank the Minister for her response? But given that some of the councils would appear reluctant in implementing the new strategies for sport for the disabled, can she raise this to the Sports Matters Implementation Group?
Well, I'll actually go further than that. I'll ask for an update, certainly from the councils, on the implementation of their disability strategies, and I'll happy to provide the member with an update of those when I receive them. And as well as that, I'll certainly be raising it at the next Sports Matters Implementation Group.
I call Jim Allister.
What progress has there been in attaining parity of esteem for all Northern Ireland athletes in terms of enabling them to compete for the national team of their choice rather than being prevented from competing for the UK if they're attached in Northern Ireland to a governing body which is All Ireland?
Well, certainly in the first instance, athletes who compete in competitions, regardless of what the configuration is, the responsibility of their governing body. It isn't the responsibility of Sport NI, and it certainly isn't the responsibility of DCAL.
I call Jim Allister.
Regrettable that the Minister cannot even afford support for the principle of parity of esteem, but she mentioned Sport NI. Will she address the discriminatory practice in Sport NI whereby they refuse to fund any group which is attached to a GB governing body if there is an alternative All-Ireland governing body? Will she address that basic discrimination?
I certainly refute the members' allegations that Sport NI are implementing discriminatory practices. In the past, the member and other members have made allegations about some of the bodies, and the arm's length bodies in particular. And what I think he needs to do is bring forward that evidence.
I call Pam Cameron.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister for assessment in relation to the reduction in the public attendance at the Ulster Folk and Transport Museum?
I'm not aware that there are significant reductions, but certainly happy to create with officials and copy the member into correspondence.
I call Pam Cameron for supplementary.
Thank you. Thank the Minister for her answer. There was something published recently in local press, but maybe when the Minister is briefed on that, she'd see the drop in numbers. And I would ask the Minister what might the National Museums Northern Ireland do to reverse the trend of what is a very important part of our cultural wealth here in Northern Ireland?
Well, I appreciate the tone in which the member has asked the question. I have seen things, certainly by museums in the press before, that upon investigation have proven to be unfounded. However, in the spirit of the tone of the question, I'm happy to bring forward this to officials, particularly to museums, try and find out exactly what's happening, and happy to write the member on that.
I call Sam Gardner.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. May I ask the Minister how many local authority museums are there in Northern Ireland and how many visitors do they have?
Well, certainly there's a difference between the independent museums and some of the private and voluntary museums and the museums in public ownership. And in terms of figures, it's a fairly detailed question and the member will appreciate. I don't have those figures at hand, but I'm happy to write to him with them.
Call Sam Gardner for supplementary.
The Minister for going to write to me, but could I ask you, are there any plans to merge local authority museums with the restructuring of local government?
Certainly not at this stage. I mean, when I was asked to transfer some functions over to local government, museums weren't. Museums and the planetarium and others were certainly down on lists to transfer over, and I refused to do it until I was convinced that local government was in a state to implement not just the services but indeed the access for everybody and do it on the basis of equality.
I call Adrian McQuillan.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. We all know how the Minister plans for the legacy of the UK city of Collier to filter down to larger towns like Limavady and Coleraine, but how does she plan to filter that down to smaller towns like Garvagh, Castle Rock and Coleraine?
Well, I would say it in the first instance as a matter for the Council. I mean, I do think small towns and villages have been somewhat overshadowed by bigger towns and cities. That's not something. If I had the investment where I could go to every corner and every small town and village or hamlet and bring the investment forward, I'd like to do, but we live in the real world. We've made investment through local government. We'll continue to do that, but it's on the basis that it caters for all its ratepayers and citizens and not just for some.
Call Adrian McCullen.
Thank the Minister for answering. Does she agree with me that it's important that these smaller towns that feel the benefit of the legacy as well as the larger ones?
I mean, I and a member will be aware even through his relationship with Limavady Borough Council, even the Stendhal Festival in Limavady, a very, very small festival in comparison to the city culture and the city of Derry. Small festival, but with a very, very significant impact, received a small amount of money, and those people in that area, and even people who visited, actually were delighted to see that such a small place received government attention, and that's the way it should be.
I call Sandra Overend.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. The Junior Irish Golf Open was held recently in Killymoon Golf Club. I'm sure the Minister is aware of the successful event that was there. I'm wondering, considering the excellent facilities that we have in Mid Ulster, that and including the Mid Ulster Sporting Arena, what is the Minister doing to ensure that these facilities have a good crack at the whip at hosting any such future events?
Well, the member should be aware that in terms of hosting events and events promotion, that's within Derry, but certainly I don't shirk my responsibility. I do think events need to be brought right across as much as possible, and that includes Mid Ulster. If the council and the new council have any plans to bring forward events, other councils have approached me about the potential of events and work in partnership with Arts Council, Museums and Sports Council. I'm happy to hear from the member if she has any specific plans.
I call Sandra Overend.
Thank you very much, and thank the Minister for that. Given the excellent competition in Cookstown and the fact that the Open Championship is to be held in Royal Portrush very shortly, what is the Minister doing to work with the Deputy Minister to encourage more sporting events to come to Northern Ireland?
Well, certainly even the award, I mean, I have continued and indeed at times increased the award to governing bodies, including the Golfing Association of Ireland, the Golfing Union of Ireland, but as well as that even through the three, through the GAA, through rugby and through soccer, and indeed through others. I have met with the IFA in particular about bringing competitions here, which includes going across the north, junior competitions as well, because it's important that we inspire children and young people. But it is really important that we still look at opportunities, regardless should it be in Belfast, in the city of Derry, Mid Ulster or wherever. And I'm happy if there are any firm proposals, because at this stage it's notional or speculative, if there are firm proposals that be brought forward to not just the Deputy Minister but myself, and we'll certainly give them due consideration.
I call Trevor Lunn.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. I understand from the Sunday Life, no less yesterday, that Linfield and Crusaders have settled their differences about the redevelopment of Windsor Park. So can the Minister give us any information about that or an update?
I don't read the Sunday Life and I wasn't aware of the story yesterday, or indeed of the stories previously that have been printed in those newspapers. I'm happy to report that the soccer family and soccer community are getting on with it despite differences previously, that they're all working to try and provide and compete for facilities, new facilities for each of their clubs. And I'm not aware of any animosity or ill feeling that there is a residue from anything previously.
Call Trevor Lunn for supplementary.
Yes, I think there was a certain amount of difference of opinion between Crusaders and Linfield, which has now been resolved. But is the Minister satisfied that in terms of the concerns of the other Irish League clubs based in the Belfast area, that their concerns will be properly addressed as this saga goes on?
Well, actually, it's not a saga. Again, if I was to respond to every piece of speculation in the newspapers, particularly some of the Sunday newspapers, that you'd spend your Mondays and Tuesdays trying to get clarification, to be sitting Wednesday and Thursday none the wiser. But I think the member's question is, are local clubs going to be supported? And the answer is, as best possible. It is important that, particularly in relation to the Amateur League, that they give full inclusion opportunities, that they in turn work with the clubs who are involved in the Irish Premiership League, and indeed work with other partnerships including schools, community groups, youth clubs and all the rest to make sure that there's greater participation, because I think some of the alleged animosity in the past has been about a perception that some clubs are going to do far better than others without even going through a process in the first place.
I call Alex Atwood.
Given the comments in the recent days about withdrawal of funding for tourist-related events, can the Minister advise the House in respect of any potential consequences in respect of the funding package promised to Royal Portrush Golf Club and the Royal and Ancient in respect of the proposed hosting of the British Open in Portrush?
I thank the member for his question. He will be aware that this is a bailiwick of Derry, but I'm certainly happy to forward a copy of the Hansard, not only to the Derry Minister, Tourist Minister, but also indeed to the Executive. And upon receipt of any response or reply, I'll copy it to the member.
Would the Minister not agree that there needs to be certainty, not doubt, in respect of the proposed hosting of the British Open? Not least because the RNA might be reading the Hansard and might be looking at events in the north and begin to wonder, are they coming or are they not coming? Is there not a need to tie this one down so that whatever the budget situation into life in the next mandate, the funding package promised to Royal Portrush and RNA is guaranteed?
In short, yes, I do think it's important that it is confirmed and it is tied down, but even just going by what I heard this morning, certainly big ticket items, big public items like that seem a bit more secure than what the Cathedral Arts would be, or even the Festival of Fools or Felly and Fubble or all the rest. So it is important that we do actually get the detail of what's at risk, what's going ahead, and certainly won't get any money at all. Before we